Ain't shady, baby, I'm hot like the prodigal son. Pick up a little leeny, meeny, money, moe, and flower, you're the chosen one.
How's everybody doing tonight? My name is Mike Aglialoro. You are here on This Is SportsZone. With, like I said, I am Mike Aglialoro. We're coming to you live on the I-95 Sports Radio Network. Once again, I want to give a big shout out to the network head, Bobby Guarente. Thank you once again for letting us join you every Friday night here. We'll be talking a little baseball. We'll be talking some football. We'll be talking some basketball. We will have David Hastings making his second appearance on the show. First time he's going to be with us since the second week our show was on the air. No Dave Tice tonight, so we're not really going to focus on the world of mixed martial arts tonight. Not really too much going on in that world this week anyway. We may just run down a couple of little minor things that are happening. I know Chris Weidman had to pull out of UFC 199. Dana White is trying to talk to Nate Diaz and Conor McGregor to see if maybe they can put something together for later in the year. Of course, they were originally scheduled to compete in UFC 200, but Conor McGregor decided he didn't want to make the appearances, so that got canceled. But right now, we'll start off the show by looking at the scoreboard. Of course, there is no NBA playoffs tonight. They resume tomorrow night with Cleveland at Toronto for game 3. And of course, Cleveland's basically been wiping the floor with Toronto so far. They are up 2-0. But as for the baseball games that are happening right now, the Mets looking to rebound off of a very lackluster showing against Washington over the last few days have taken the lead 3-2 over the Milwaukee Brewers. They put themselves in a 2-0 hole at the end of the first inning, but they have clawed their way back. It is now the bottom of the second inning. There is one man on, and the Mets have already scored 2 in the inning. To pull it up here, let you know. Michael Conforto hit another home run tonight, 2-run shot. Cespedes singled. He was caught stealing later. Now there are 2 men on again, as Lucas Duda was hit by a pitch, and Eric Campbell walked. That's good to see if you are a Met fan. As I said, Steven Matz gave up 2 runs in the first inning off of a Chris Carter 2-run home run. But he has settled in and pitched the next 5 innings scoreless. He has gone 6 innings. He has thrown 7 strikeouts thus far. We'll go back to that one in a little while. We'll talk some more Mets in a little while. Looking at the rest of the scoreboard, the Atlanta Braves are up 2-1 on the Philadelphia Phillies, who currently sit in second place in the National League East, to the surprise of everyone. And they just went to the bottom of the 6th inning. Atlanta, of course, fired Freddy Gonzalez, their manager, earlier in the week. We'll talk about that in a little while. The Colorado Rockies and Pittsburgh Pirates are tied at 1 apiece in the bottom of the 6th. The Pirates have a man on second base. Cleveland Indians are up 4-2 over the Boston Red Sox. Jackie Bradley Jr. has extended his hitting streak to 25 games. He is now only 9 games behind Dom DiMaggio, for the longest hitting streak in Red Sox history. The Tampa Bay Rays are tied 3-3 against the Tigers in Detroit. The Rays have a man on first base in the top of the sixth inning. We're in the third inning, and Cincinnati is up 1-0 on the Seattle Mariners. The Washington Nationals, coming off their impressive showing over the last couple days over the New York Mets, are up 4-1 over the Miami Marlins in the top of the seventh inning. Chicago White Sox are up 1-0 over the Kansas City Royals in the middle of the third inning as they head to the bottom of the third inning. That's a big series to watch in the AL Central. The Toronto Blue Jays are up 2-1 over the Minnesota Twins as we are in the top of the third inning in that one. We have the Texas Rangers and Houston Astros, which are scoreless in the top of the third inning. The Rangers have a man on third base there. We're in the bottom of the second inning in St. Louis as they are trailing the Arizona Diamondbacks 2-1. As I said, we are in the bottom of the second inning there. And the games that we'll be playing later on tonight, the Yankees head to Oakland to take on the Oakland A's. CeCe Sabathia comes off the disabled list to take on Sonny Gray, the ace of the A's staff, who has had a very lackluster showing to begin the year. He is 3-4 with a 5.84 ERA. And, of course, he had some grand expectations on him at the beginning of the season. He was kind of hovering around the top 10, top 20 pitchers in all of baseball, and he has gotten off to a poor start. And the Yankees, of course, had a better week this week. They went 7-3 on their recent homestand. They are 6-4 over the last 10 games, and they are now 18-22 on the season as they hope to climb back into at least a .500 record. Baltimore Orioles take on the Los Angeles Angels of Anaheim later on tonight at 10:05. Mike Wright starts for the Orioles against Hector Santiago, who is the de facto ace of the Angels staff amidst all their injuries, who is 3-2 with a 3.42 ERA. Chicago Cubs, fresh off their three-game sweep at the hands of the Milwaukee Brewers, take on the San Francisco Giants in San Francisco at 10:15 tonight. Jake Arrieta looks for his eighth win of the season. He is currently 7-0 with a 1.29 ERA. And Jake Peavy starts for the Giants. He of a 1-4 record with a 7.43 ERA. And the other game that will be taking place later on tonight, you have the Los Angeles Dodgers heading to San Diego to take on the Padres. Scott Kazmir, 3-3 with a 4.89 ERA, takes on Christian Frederick for the Padres. So we'll talk about some of the things that have happened in the world of baseball this week. Of course, we'll start with the Mets. The Mets got swept over the weekend by the Colorado Rockies, and then they welcomed the Washington Nationals into Citi Field for a three-game series, which started off on a promising enough note. They won 2-0 against the Nationals and Max Scherzer on Tuesday night. And then over the last two games, it kind of went downhill. They lost on Wednesday by a score of 7-1. Bartolo Colon took the loss in that game. And then last night, Matt Harvey, continuing his poor start to the season, gave up 2 runs in the first inning and 7 runs in the third inning. He had his worst start in his young career, lasted only 2 2/3, which is a career worst for him, and the 7 runs are the most he's allowed in one inning over the course of, as I said, his young career. So, and of course, you know, Mets fans are ones who will overreact. As much as I am one of them, sometimes I am embarrassed by my own fan base, quite frequently, actually. Boom! Matt Harvey as he came off the mound. And of course, the big question is whether or not the Mets should skip him for his next start. As we said, Steven Matz did make his scheduled start tonight after he was skipped over the weekend. Logan Verrett did not fill in an impressive fashion on Saturday when he replaced Matz in the rotation. Verrett did wind up coming in and pitching in relief of Harvey 2 1/3 scoreless innings. So we saw that. And the bullpen has been performing well. They didn't give up anything over the course of the 5 1/3 innings after Harvey left the game. But again, Harvey, what do you do with them? What is causing this? Is it hangover from last season, pitching close to 230 innings, including the playoffs, and blowing past the suggested 180 limit for pitchers coming off of Tommy John surgery? I feel it's a little bit of that, but Terry Collins did bring up a good point that he did have the urinary tract infection, bladder problem, right before the season started, and some feel he hasn't really looked quite right since. I think it's just a case of a guy trying to do too much to please himself, to please the fan base. He's got dollar signs in his eyes with his free agency looming after the 2018 season, to the point where I just don't think he's really allowing himself to just go out and pitch to his capabilities the way he has in the past, the way he did in 2013 when he took the National League by storm, the way he did in the postseason last year when he came back in the National League Championship Series and later in the World Series and had a very successful show. And, of course, Game 5 didn't end the way anyone would have liked to have seen it, but he pitched very well until that ill-fated ninth inning. So I personally don't think skipping him a start would really hurt anyone in the grand scheme of things, because he would either be pitching Monday or Tuesday next week. Realistically, it would be Tuesday. He wouldn't be pitching Monday unless they really wanted to throw him on 3 days rest, which is no reason to do this early in the season. So he'd be pitching Tuesday, and he'd be pitching in Washington against those very same Washington Nationals. Again, I don't think it would be the worst thing to skip him to start just to try to let him get his mind right. And in the end, it's not late in the season. The pennant race hasn't really started yet. Teams are still gearing up. I mean, if you really want to see, the Philadelphia Phillies are in second place right now. They're 24-17. And you know, good to hell well, the Phillies will not be in a pennant chase come September. They will not be in a wild card race come September. There are always teams that start off well and then flounder over the summer months. Conversely, there are always teams and players who get off to rough starts and then get things righted as the season goes along. And the fact is, the Mets are very much in that position right now. 22-18 is not a bad start by any stretch of the imagination. But if the Mets are going to pitch in meaningful October games, they need their full assortment of pitchers, and that includes Harvey. And they need him pitching at an all-star caliber level. And the only way you're going to get that is if he does, in fact, get his mind right. Now, what that entails, again, if you have to skip him a start to get him back on the right path, there's nothing wrong with doing that. But you know, like I said, I mean, this is where we are right now. I'd like to think Harvey still will recover and find his past form as we move forward this season. But right now, things are looking a little dicey. With the 9 runs he gave up last night, and only 6 of them were earned, his ERA jumps back up to 5.77. His WHIP is now 1.66. And neither of those are really numbers you want out of the guy you kind of expected to be. I mean, not kind of. You did expect him to be one of your aces, one of your stalwarts. The Mets are fortunate to be in a position where you do have Jacob DeGrom and Noah Syndergaard. And as much as DeGrom hasn't looked great by any stretch yet, he has fought through some games. He has shown the heart that has made everybody love him over the last couple of years. The ace of this staff right now is Noah Syndergaard. I don't think anybody can dispute that right now. Steven Matz is definitely putting himself very well in his own right, given the way his season started. I mean, and just to give you an update right now, they just got out of the top of the seventh inning. They're in the bottom of the seventh inning now. Steven Matz, seven innings. The last six have been scoreless. He's struck out eight, and he's only at 88 pitches right now. So more than likely, I would say he comes back to pitch the eighth inning. That's where you are right now. But the other problem, if you're a Mets fan looking at this team, is the fact, and we talked about this a couple weeks ago, you want to say they're getting home run happy? I don't think you can deny they're getting home run happy. But at this point, it really is home run or nothing. Because the fact is, you scored two runs over the last 2 days. The only win in the National Series came on Tuesday night off two home runs. These guys are going up to the plate thinking home run every time. They're not thinking fundamentals. They are trying to drive the ball every time. They're not thinking, hey, if I get on base, maybe the next guy will get on base. Maybe the guy after that just gets it out of the infield and I can score from second base. They're not thinking this at all. They're all going up to that plate trying to hit the ball out and break up destroy deficits with one swing. And when you get yourself into a 7-1 or a 9-1 hole, guess what? One swing doesn't get you back in anything. So to me, that is as big of a problem as what is going on with Torby right now. And, you know, what everyone thought was going to be the weak spot of this team heading into the season, the bullpen really has done its part through the first month and a half of this season. Because I got to tell you, you may not consider anyone in that bullpen to be dominant, and they haven't been dominant. They've done the job, though, from J.Rus Familia as the closer to Antonio Bastardo to Jim Henderson, who nobody expected to have a big role on this team this season, to Jerry Blevins, to Hansel Robles. Even Sean Gilmartin did fairly well during his time with the team. He, of course, has been sent back down, and Matt Reynolds was called up earlier this week. And, you know, I'll go through some of the numbers from the relievers this season, because, you know, this shows the bullpen has not been the weak spot on this team. You could say it may not hold up over the course of the season, because, you know, the fact is, we're 40 games into the season. I see Robles going 20 games so far. Addison Reed has pitched 20 games thus far. Familia, Blevins, and Henderson have all pitched in 19 games this season. And Bastardo has been in 17. So you have half your bullpen already pitching in half the games you've been in this season. And nobody is holding up over the course of the season if they are being used that much. I can tell you that. And that really is a testament to the shakiness that no one really expected out of the pitching staff, whether it was DeGrom struggles, Harvey struggles, Matt's the first start, and he had to miss the start last season, and Verrett did not get the job done on Saturday, like I said. Cologne has been good at times, but he's pitched like a fifth starter, which is not a terrible thing, but he's not giving you the length you would really like to see out of him. You know, he's pitching in 48 innings this year, 8 game starts. I think he went 2 innings the first game of the season in relief. It was the first or second game of the season. He pitched that in relief. So he's got 46 innings through 8 starts. That's not even 6 innings a start. From a guy like Cologne, you would like to see 6 or 7 innings out of him. He's not on a pitch count or anything. You would like to see that. Now, of course, he is 43 years old. Whether or not he can still give you that, it's pretty apparent he can't still give you that. And that's not helping. Syndergaard, 8 starts, 53 in the third innings. He doesn't go into the seventh inning a lot of the times. DeGrom, 36 innings through six starts. That's 6 innings to start right now. If these guys are only going to go 6 innings and you have to worry about the bottom 3 innings, you know, maybe that's what you expected going into the season. But the fact is, you're not going to be able to use the same 3 guys every night. And we know Terry Collins likes to play the matchups. So what happens is he's using 4 or 5 relievers every game. Now, sometimes because of the matchups, maybe you need that. But if anybody honestly thinks this bullpen is holding up being used that much, you haven't been paying attention to the way bullpens in baseball work over the last few years. So those are my worries when it comes to this team so far. And we'll look at some of the other things going on in baseball right now. As I said earlier in the show, Freddy Gonzalez was fired earlier this week by the Atlanta Braves after a 9-28 start. And, you know, I talked about this a few weeks ago, how a lot of front offices like to make the manager the cause of teams' woes. And in this case, Freddy Gonzalez is bearing the brunt of a decision that he did not make. Because the Braves front office before last season decided that they were going to go into a full-bore rebuild mode. And they traded away a lot of their team. And they continued that this past season. And when you have a skeleton roster with a lot of guys who are getting major league experience for the first time, and your only real proven major league players are Freddie Freeman and Ender Encantare, the outfielder they got from Arizona, and Julio Terahan, who really has not been anything close to that top prospect he was a few years ago. And the fact is, no one's really doing their job. You can only blame the manager so much. If they didn't want him to be the manager, they probably should have replaced him sooner. But what I also think is funny, there's an article on Yahoo that was written on Wednesday by Dan Gilson, who's actually an Associated Press sports writer. And it seems Freddy Gonzalez is taking everything in good spirits. I mean, the fact is, he found out that he was fired from an automatically generated email. The email he received on Monday had been sent from the team's travel agency that informed him that his flight for the next day had been booked from Pittsburgh to Atlanta while the Braves were scheduled to play in Pittsburgh through Thursday night. Which I just think is very distasteful for an organization that is supposedly one of the class organizations in the league. Now, apparently, Gonzalez took everything in stride because that Monday night, he apparently brought 2 bottles of wine to the hotel room of Atlanta general manager John Coppola. And they sat and they talked and they shot the breeze for a little while. And then Braves president John Hart called in and told Gonzalez that he planned to make the move. And apparently it was an amicable split. But, you know, the fact is, this is a good manager right here. As much as he did not get what I feel is a fair shake this season or last year, considering the talent pool he had to work with and the decision that was made for him in terms of the rebuilding process. You know, if you're the front office and you're going to entrust in a rebuilding process, you can't fault the manager if you're worse than you thought the team was going to be. You know, everybody knew going into the season that the Braves were going to be bad. Everybody knew that they were going to be fighting for last place in the National League East. We all thought it was going to be fighting with the Phillies, and it may still wind up that way. But to hold a manager responsible for a decision he did not make, to me, is very cowardly, and it's just completely making the manager the scapegoat for something he had no control over. And I'm not a fan of it. I'm not. I wasn't a fan of it, like I said. When it was the Philadelphia 76ers who let their general manager go this past season because Sam Hinkie decided that his grandioso idea to start this dramatic rebuild over the last 3 years wasn't working out, and he decided to bring in the Colangelos and basically sacrifice the general manager so that, you know, he could make his constituents happy. You know something? The ownership made that decision, and the general manager is the one who tried to see it through. He did it to the best of the ability. But you know something? He was going by your edict. I don't even know what else to say. But the fact is, Gonzalez should get another manager job, if not during the season, at some point after the season. Because the fact is, even with the way it is this season, he is 710 and 692 over the course of his career. And I believe he has managed for parts of 6 seasons. And I consider that impressive when you consider the fact that he lost about 20 games off that record as a result of this past season. So, we'll continue. Something I saw happened earlier today. Baseball is apparently going to change the strike zone and change the approach of an intentional walk. Now, we're going to change the strike zone and raise it to the lower part of the strike zone to the top of the hitter's knees, which is funny to me because I always thought that's where the strike zone was supposed to be in the first place. But apparently, the strike zone began at the hollow beneath the kneecap, which makes absolutely no sense to me whatsoever. So I don't know where the hollow on most people's kneecap begins, but to me, that's like 3 inches off the ground. And I think we all know the strike zone don't begin 3 inches off the ground. The only time you see something like that happen is a curveball that passes through the strike zone and winds up on the ground. And they call that a strike because it didn't pass through the strike zone. So to me, they are reinstituting the classic strike zone, which I'm fine with. I got to be honest. You may see this affect pitchers who are more reliant on that curveball to get players out. Maybe a Noah Syndergaard suffers from this at some point. I'm sure there were a few others. But again, you're changing the strike zone the way everybody thought it was to begin with. At least that's my opinion. Before we go on, I just want to remind everyone we can take phone calls here. So if anybody listening wants to join in on the conversation, feel free to give us a call at 1-605-562-8001. And you dial 5 to join in on the conversation live here on the Sports Zone. I am your host, Mike Aglialoro. Should be joined by Dave Hastings, good friend of mine, former host of This Is Sports Up, when it was weekday show. We haven't heard from him since our second week on the air here. We're going to be talking NBA playoffs this week. There were a few more coaching changes in the NBA. Jeff Hornacek announced as the Knicks head coach. Frank Vogel, former Pacers head coach, is now the head coach of the Orlando Magic. So we'd be talking with him about that. Because it's been a while since we've had him on, we'll talk about some of the other coaching changes that have happened since the last time he was on the show. Luke Walton was named Lakers head coach. Dave Joerger went from the Grizzlies head coach to the Kings head coach. So we'll talk about all that. Now, the other change to the rules that is expected to happen is the intentional walk rule would end the traditional practice of requiring the pitcher to lob 4 balls outside the strike zone. Instead, a team can signify it wants to issue an intentional walk, and the hitter would be immediately sent to first base. Now, just so we're clear here, these rules were agreed to by the Competition Committee and Major League Baseball's owners' meetings this past week, according to Jason Stark, senior writer at ESPN.com. These changes cannot go into effect unless they are approved by baseball's Playing Rules Committee, which is made up of a cross-section of baseball executives. Sources said the changes would also be presented to the MLB Players Association as part of negotiations for a new labor agreement. However, the Playing Rules Committee isn't required to have the union sign off on the change, so they could take effect next season whether or not the union agrees to them. Don't think that won't be a point of contention during the next labor negotiations. And these changes are, of course, designed to address concerns Rob Manfred and others have about the pace of play. Of course, we know they introduced the time clock to try to speed up time between pitchers take between pitches, the amount of time coaches spend going to the mound and that sort of thing. Hopefully it works. Listen, we all know baseball is, I'm not going to call it a boring sport because I think diehard fans don't consider it that way. But I think we know it is probably the longest of all the sports if you take out commercial breaks because everyone's got to get their ads in. Because Lord knows football has caught up to baseball in terms of length of play, if for no other reason than because of all the commercials you see on a Sunday when you're trying to watch a football game. So there's that. We'll switch to the Yankees a little bit here. Alex Rodriguez, who is eligible to return after he's been on the DL since the early part of the month. It doesn't look like he's coming back this weekend. It looks like they are trying to have him back when they return home to play the Toronto Blue Jays on Tuesday night. And apparently he did a little right light running the bases on Friday. Practice going first to third and third to home. Practice going halfway on the fly ball to the outfield. And practice taking the wide turn at first base after getting it in. Listen, I think the Yankees have played a little better as of late. But, you know, if they are going to do anything, it's on the players, such as Alex Rodriguez, to do much better than they did over the first month and a half. And Hal Steinbrenner basically said the same thing earlier in the week, that he does not blame Joe Girardi for the way the team has been. Excuse me. I just want to pull up the article here. I think we know you can't put all the blame for the way the Yankees have been this season on Joe Girardi. He's given a team of elder statesmen. They are one of the oldest teams in baseball right now. And you knew their weaknesses going into the season. It was the starting pitching, and it was the age of the offense. Could they still perform at their prime levels, given the fact that just about all of them are past their primes? And we know they were not able to address any of their major weaknesses this offseason. You know, they tried to get a little younger, bringing a start on Castro and Aaron Hicks, and they brought in Chapman in the bullpen. And, of course, this was the first week you were able to see Betances, Miller, and Chapman all in the same game, the way the Yankees grew it up at the beginning of the season. Which has got to make all Yankee fans happy. But the fact is, the offense doesn't do their job. The starting pitching doesn't hold the lead. There's no reason for those three to get in the game. And Girardi can't hit the ball. He can only do so much. I mean, Girardi can barely hit the ball when he was a player. Damn sure ain't going to do it when he's the manager now. And, yeah, Hal Steinbrenner basically absolved Girardi and all the coaches for the slow start to the season. He blamed the players for the team's slow start. I'm going to read a quote here. The first 5 weeks were disappointing, frustrating, particularly looking at the offense. Clearly not living up to their potential. When you look at a guy like Mark Teixeira, clearly he's not playing to his potential with the bat. He called Pineda's decline concerning. Michael Pineda has not been very good this season at all. All these strikeouts, referring to the fact that Pineda always has a lot of strikeouts, and yet he's giving up all these runs. Whatever technically is wrong with delivery, Larry Rothschild is going to work on, but the rest is up to Pineda to figure it out. He's a professional, and that's what we expect from him. That's what his teammates expect from him. As for Lou Severino, who of course is on the disabled list after his dreadful start to the season, Steinbrenner said the pitcher has a confidence issue and has to learn how to push through that downturn. Excuse me 1 second, folks. Sorry to do that on the air, but that was just killing me since we started. Much better. He praised Starlin Castro and Aaron Hicks, who, like I said, were two of the big additions that Brian Cashman made this offseason. He praised Girardi, Rothschild, and Cashman. He said the coaches are doing a good job. These are professional athletes. They're the best baseball players in the world. And sooner or later, it comes down to them on the inside to push through whatever it is they're going through and to persevere. Now, obviously, this is a far cry from George Steinbrenner, who I think any reasonable person would know that if Steinbrenner was alive, he probably would have fired everybody and made about 15 trades by now. He would have tried to sell everybody off. But in the end, and we said this a few weeks ago, the Yankees are paying now for their gross overspending during the early 2000s, during the early part of the century. I mean, the fact is, and we said this a few weeks ago, so this will probably sound redundant. Before the 2014 season, when they brought in Masahiro Tanaka, and they brought in Jacoby Ellsbury and Carlos Beltran and Chase Headley, they really were, that was their attempt at bringing in, I mean, obviously everyone tries to bring in new talent, but the Yankees have not been a team that builds through the farm system. So in the end, them doing that was in lieu of being able to restock the farm system. And you can't build a team that way by spending $500 million in one offseason to basically maintain your status quo. Because the Yankees had an elder team when they made those moves. And you knew Headley was already in his 30s. Ellsbury was already in his 30s. Beltran was in his late 30s. Tanaka was the youngest one, and he was the one whose contract had the opt-out clause halfway through it. And you just know if Tanaka had actually, and in my opinion, he has lived up to the contract when he's been healthy, but the health has been an issue. If the health hadn't been an issue, and he had done what he was supposed to do the entire time here, there would probably be speculation as to whether or not he's going to opt out this year or next year. I can't remember if the opt-out is after the third year or the fourth year. I think it's the fourth year. But you know that question would be looming if he had been able to stay healthy. So that's a problem. And we're seeing it play out now. Because the Yankees have decided not to feed the beast over the last two seasons and let their elder players' contracts expire before trying to hit the free agent market again, and because they have tried to simply look for value in trades, and because they have tried to simply integrate younger players into the team when they've been able to, instead of adding the flashy, high-priced name that maybe would have been good for a quick fix but not a long-term solution, this is merely the buildup of all that spending on top of spending to cover holes. You know, every team needs to rebuild at some point, whether it's a long rebuild or a short rebuild, every team has to go through it. We saw the Mets go through a really long one and finally come out of it last season. We saw the Cubs go through a long one and finally come out of it last season. The Royals were rebuilding for 20 years and have now been to two consecutive World Series and won last season. The Giants, maybe they didn't go through a quote-unquote rebuild, but they weren't exactly a darling of the baseball world until the last few years, when they relied on the strength of young pitchers such as Matt Cain, Madison Bumgarner, Tim Lincecum, Buster Posey, young players that they also had in their farm system. Posey the catcher, Pablo Sandoval, a homegrown third baseman. And they supplemented that with shrewd acquisitions, such as Hunter Pence, Angel Pagan, betting on him to have a bounce back year when they got him. And you can go on down the line with other players they brought in. They always had a deep bullpen, but they didn't exactly go after the big names. They relied on the strength of the scouting department. Brian Wilson was a homegrown talent. Sergio Romo, homegrown talent. Santiago Castilla, homegrown talent. These are the guys they built their dynasty around, basically. And they didn't do it with bloated payrolls, for the most part. The Giants have spent more in recent years after they won their first couple of championships. Of course, we saw that this offseason, spending close to $200 million to bring in Johnny Cueto and Jeff Samardzija to strengthen their rotation. And both those guys have worked out. And it also helps if you bring in starting pitchers to a pitcher's ballpark like San Francisco has, as opposed to a bandbox like Yankee Stadium. And you have to wonder if that's part of the reason why maybe they didn't give big money to certain pitchers. Because, you know, this year's pitching crop of free agents was entirely top-heavy. They didn't want to spend the money on David Price or Zach Greinke or Samardzija or Cueto. And then it kind of dropped after that to your Mike Leakes and your Scott Kazmirs and guys like that. I think any reasonable person can speculate that if those guys had gone to Yankee Stadium, it would have been more bad contracts on top of bad contracts. So, I mean, that's where the Yankees are at right now. And just to show you some of the statistics here, Teixeira, former three-time All-Star, finished after Wednesday night with a .203 batting average and 11 RBIs through his start of the season. Chase Headley didn't have an extra base hit until May 12th. Severino went 0-6 with a 7.46 ERA before going on the disabled list. And Pineda is 1-5 with a 6.60 ERA, which is 102nd among 104 qualifying pitchers in the major leagues. There's not that much you can say about that, folks. If the players on the field aren't going to perform for you, you can't put it all on the manager. And whereas the Braves were quick to jettison their manager, who would have thought it would have been a Steinbrenner who backed his manager? That's funny. That's where we are now. Where a Steinbrenner has more patience than the Braves ownership. And the Braves get body cocks for over 20 years. That's unreal. But, like I said, I mean, the Yankees' recent homestand, for all intents and purposes, was a success. I mean, they won 2 of 3 games against the Boston Red Sox. Won 2 of 3 games against the three of four games against the Kansas City Royals. Then last week, They took two of three games against the Chicago White Sox. And then they went to Arizona this week. And that's when it kind of went off the rails. They lost two of three games to Arizona. I believe Zach Greinke pitched in one of those games. Zach Greinke looked a little bit better. He, of course, got off to a poor start in his own right. And the Yankees won their first game against Oakland last night to a score of 4-1. So, I mean, right now, the Yankees' mission is simply to get up to 500 before you think about anything else. 18-22 right now, they have to get up to 22-22. Then you can do whatever you want after that. But, again, if you go to the website, thisissportszone.com, the poll that we've had up for a couple weeks now, and anybody is free to vote on it whenever you would like, should the Yankees be sellers at this year's trading deadline? Speculate yes or no, if you would like. So it's 9:30 right now, and I want to apologize to everyone who is looking forward to it. But as I said earlier in the show, we will not have Dave Tice with us this week. He's on a personal matter. Maybe he's doing some scouting. To give us some notes when he comes back for the MMA segment. He will be out this week, and he will be out next week. Like I said, I'm just going to mention some UFC stories real quick. Obviously, I'm not the UFC guy, so I am not going to go in depth here. Chris Weidman had to pull out of UFC 199. And they named a replacement for him earlier today. Michael Bisping will be taking on middleweight champion Luke Rockhold, who is the guy that Weidman was going to be facing at UFC 199. There is a Bellator fight going on right now. Bellator 155 is going on. And middleweight champion Rafael Carvalho will be taking on contender Melvin Manhoff in the main event. And I'm just going to mention this story here. UFC meets with Nate Diaz to talk about a rematch with Conor McGregor. And UFC President Dana White and CEO Lorenzo Fertitta met with Nate Diaz on Friday in Stockholm, California to discuss a potential rematch against Conor McGregor. But White indicated in a text message to ESPN that the talks did not go well, saying, quote, "It wasn't a good day." It occurred 2 days after UFC brass met with McGregor on Wednesday evening in Los Angeles. According to a source, the two sides did not come to an agreement on financial terms during the meeting on Friday. They did drive to a nearby mural of Diaz to take a photo together, which Diaz posted on his Instagram account. Of course, like we said, they were supposed to fight at UFC 200. UFC pulled the plug on that after McGregor refused to fly to Los Angeles for a news conference and commercial shoot. They offered Diaz a replacement fight at UFC 200, but he said he was only interested in fighting McGregor. Diaz requested the meeting in Stockholm after White and Fertitta were willing to fly to Los Angeles to meet McGregor. Diaz has publicly stated he doesn't think UFC has given him credit for defeating McGregor in their first bout. Should the parties come to terms on a rematch, a Diaz-McGregor bout could possibly headline UFC 202, which is expected to take place in August, possibly in Las Vegas. In the meantime, McGregor has been fueling speculation. The Floyd Mayweather thing, which we're not even really going to talk about, because I still don't think it's going to happen. You know, apparently on Friday, Mayweather offered McGregor $50 million to fight him. Of course, Mayweather would want that fight because you know he would probably win. Look at some of the other baseball stories here for right now. Like I said, Dave Hastings should be on at 10 o'clock. Right now it is 9:34, so I just want to say you are listening to This is Sports Zone. With me, I am Mike Aglialoro. We are live here on the I-95 Sports Radio Network. If you guys want to call in, you give us a call at 1-605-562-8001. Now, one thing I saw earlier today is former major leaguer Joey Cora, former Yankee, who is currently a manager in AA and wants to be a manager in the big leagues. Thinks that Major League Baseball's hiring system for managerial openings is unfair to Hispanic candidates. He had an interview on an ESPN show, and he discussed the lack of Hispanic managers in the majors, and he said that qualified Hispanic candidates simply need a chance. Now, of course, Freddy Gonzalez was actually the first, he was the only Hispanic manager in the major leagues, and he's no longer a manager now. According to Cora, when you have Sandy Alomar, Alex Cora, his brother, Eduardo Perez, Dave Martinez, who was actually up for the Dodgers managerial vacancy before they went with Dave Roberts this past offseason. He said, I've been in the major leagues. I've coached in the major leagues. I managed in the big leagues a few games because someone got thrown out. I've been a bench coach, too. Some of the guys tell us we have to go through the minor league system to get experience. I don't think that is fair. All they have to do is give us a chance, the same chance you give everyone. It's not because we are Latinos. Our resume speaks for itself. Now, my question here, and you know, maybe I'm out of line for answering this question. I really wonder how much Ozzie Guillen set back the course of Hispanic major leaguers, Hispanic managers in the major leagues with everything that happened during his tenure with the Miami Marlins. Now, of course, he started his managerial career with the Chicago White Sox. And he was kind of forced out. He got in a lot of fights with the general manager. And then he resurfaced in Miami. And then within his first month, he pissed off the entire Latino community in Miami by basically applauding things that Fidel Castro had done. And, of course, he wasn't long for the Marlins managerial job after that. It just makes you wonder. I mean, Freddy Gonzalez was the replacement for Ozzie Guillen, if I'm not mistaken. And then he resurfaced with the Braves. But, again, I don't know. This is just me here. You really wonder if maybe that had gone better. Would there have been more Hispanic players who became coaches getting their shot as manager in the big leagues? I think it's a fair question to ask because I don't really think it's saying anything that baseball has a diversity problem. I mean, you have a lot of Latino players, but you don't really see them get managerial jobs. I mean, Guillen, Gonzalez, Manny Acta was a manager with the Cleveland Indians for a couple of years. His teams did not do very well. Cora was a bench coach on a couple of teams. I believe he was with Boston for a little while. He managed in the Mets minor league system for a little while. Expos minor league system in 2003. He was bench coach in Chicago for the White Sox under Ozzie Guillen and the Miami Marlins. Apparently he was a serious candidate in 2008 when the Mariners were looking for a head coach, but they ultimately hired Don Wakamatsu. I don't know. I think it's a poor message that baseball is sending that, you know, we'll let the Hispanics play in the majors, we'll let them get coaching jobs, but we won't really entrust them to be long-term head coaches, which is basically the message you're sending right now. You know, they have a Rooney Rule in the NFL. And baseball has the Selig Rule, which requires all Major League Baseball teams to consider minority candidates for openings as general manager, assistant general manager, manager, director of player developments, or director of scouting. And according to Cora, quote, I have been interviewed, and when I tell them I went to Vanderbilt University, the guys that are doing the interview are surprised. So that tells me it might be a checkmark interview for the C-League interview. That's wrong. That's a process that is faulty. The guys that interview you are not prepared to interview you. They're saying, we got this guy to interview. We're going to put a check mark, and we have done our job. We complied with the rule. That's not right. What else we got? That's wrong. Excuse me. That's not right. Some guys say, I'm not going to interview because I know it's for the C-League rule for a check mark. But we have to keep fighting because one of these days, one of these guys will be so good that the owner or the general manager will say we have to hire this guy. And he's right. Sooner or later, there will be more Hispanic managers in the major leagues, I feel. You know, it's the way. I mean, whenever you have... And I feel like half of baseball right now is Latin American. So I feel like you can't not recognize them on a higher level if you're willing to employ them as some of the best players in the game. You know, one way or another, it's going to be a circular effect. If you don't allow them to manage or allow them to have prominent roles with organizations, it's going to trickle down. In my opinion, it'll trickle down to the point where maybe not with this generation, but with the younger generation, they'll realize that there's only a certain amount baseball will allow them to do, and maybe they decide to pursue something else. And another thing I got to wonder if it really affected is, you know, Ruben Amaro did a terrible job as the general manager of the Phillies. I mean, we all know he started the rebuilding process for that team a year or two too late. So, I mean, and let's be honest here. You look at the way things have gone in Philadelphia in terms of the talent they brought in last year when they finally went full bore into their rebuilding process. You really have to wonder how much more could they have gotten if they started the process a year or two earlier. You can't help but wonder that. So, this is a funny story to me. We all know Barry Bonds is the hitting coach for the Miami Marlins now, who have not gotten off to a good start this season. And none more so than Giancarlo Stanton, who is in a 4-for-41 funk that has dropped his average to .221 with strikeouts in his past 7 at bat, 11 home runs on the season, only 1 RBI since May 6th. And apparently Bonds is now trying to help him through that. And I know this is probably a horrible thing to say, but because it's Barry Bonds, and I thought this when he was hired as hitting coach, what is his advice to Giancarlo Stanton going to be other than, hey, man, I'll meet you in the bathroom and we'll work through your hitting problems. Just make sure you bring a fresh syringe. I know it's a bad joke, but I'm sorry. Yeah. Barry Bonds may have a lot to offer, but the idea of him helping players bust out of hitting slumps and all that stuff, you know, yeah, great major leaguer, all that stuff. Legacy's forever tainted, and I just don't get it. I'll never get why he's back in the major leagues. You won't let him in the Hall of Fame, you'll let him coach. Same thing with Mark McGwire. Doesn't make sense to me. Anyway, we will go back to the scoreboard now to see where we're at with some of the games that are going on now. And once again, anybody wants to call in, it's free to call in. 1-605-562-8001. You can dial 5 to join in on the conversation. Ask any question you would like. No prank calls, please. That's my only ad. Hey, the Mets went final. They beat the Milwaukee Brewers 3-1. Steven Matz gets his 6th consecutive win. He is now 6-1 on the season. I just want to pull up the full stats here. Like I said, Conforto, the big blast, the big 2-1 shot. What a surprise. The Mets win because someone hit another home run. That is just the most shocking thing that is going to happen tonight. His 7th home run of the season. And they didn't let him go back out for the 8th inning. Like I said, I thought they would let him go back out because he only had 88 pitches thrown. But there's no fault in trying to play it safe. because they did just skip him a start with the elbow problem. So erring on the side of caution is not the worst thing in the world. Addison Reed pitched a scoreless eighth inning, and Jairus Familia got his 14th save of this season. So that's great. They are going to run this bullpen into the ground, though. Let me tell you that. So I think just for that, you can expect them to try to add a reliever at the trade deadline. I think they're going to try to add a reliever and a right-handed bat at some point, because they are terrible against left-handed pitchers right now. We saw that on Wednesday against Gio Gonzalez. I apologize, folks. I am battling a little cold. God knows we love the constant changing of the weather. It was 70 degrees today. Edgar was in the 40s and 50s earlier in the week. And we're not even in June. More than halfway through May. Still haven't gotten constant weather. I don't want to hear nothing about global warming. It's screwing it with everyone. It is not a conspiracy by the Chinese to get you to spend more money, folks. We're going to look at some of the other scores here. As I said, Jackie Bradley Jr. has a 25-game hitting streak going. That's amazing for a guy who could barely hit on a major league level as recently as last season. He has really turned it around, and Red Sox are looking very smart for not trading him, even though they had ample opportunity to do so. Even though, having said that, they are losing to the Indians 4-2 as we head to the bottom of the eighth inning there. Atlanta is pounding the Phillies 5-1, top of the ninth inning. The Braves have a man on first base. Tampa Bay is taking the lead over Detroit 6-5, man on first base with two out in the top of the seventh inning. We're going into the ninth inning. The Nationals are still leading 4-1 over the Marlins. Toronto up 4-1 over Minnesota. Two men on, two out at the top of the sixth inning. Arizona beating the St. Louis Cardinals 4-1 in the bottom of the fifth. St. Louis has a man on first base. Patrick Corbin is starting for Arizona. The guy I've been a big fan on. He hasn't had the greatest start this year. Not a terrible ERA, but hey, you know, when you have a 1.34 whip, that is not what you want to see in your start in one of your starting pitchers, especially someone who the Diamondbacks are really counting on him, as much as they were Shelby Miller, to really anchor that staff behind Zach Greinke. So you can't like that. Carlos Martinez started for the Cardinals. He's gone five innings, given up four runs. He's had his own kind of off-field problems. He had some illness last week, and I would say it's affecting him right now because he was off to a blistering hot start at one point. The Reds are beating the Mariners 3-1 in Cincinnati as we head to the bottom of the sixth inning there. White Sox and Royals are tied 1-1 in the top of the sixth, and the Royals have two men on with one out. And if you're a Royal fan right now, 20-20 to start the season. They are currently in third place in the AL Central. The White Sox behind a 9-0 Chris Sale. He is just smoking hot so far this year. He had another great start the other night. And they are really surprising a lot of people with the way they are taking charge of the AL Central. They're 2.5 games in front of the second place Cleveland Indians. White Sox 25-16, Indians 21-17. And the Tigers can't get out of their own way, apparently. I mean, Jordan Zimmermann surprised everyone with his hot start, but then 19-21, Verlander hasn't been great. The offense hasn't been great to start the year. It's just not a good situation. They are in danger of letting this division get entirely out of hand if they don't turn things around very quickly. Texas is beating the Astros 2-0 as we head to the top of the seventh inning. And we just started in Oakland. Yankees had two hits in the top of the first inning but could do nothing with it. And they actually had a man on first and third with two out. Yeah, let me see here. No, I'm reading this wrong. Hang on. The way it happened, Ellsbury grounded out to start the game off. Gardner flied to center. Beltran doubled. McCann singled to left. Beltran went to third. And Teixeira couldn't do anything with it. Flied out to end the inning. Now, Sabathia is back making his first start since the beginning of the month. We'll see if the time off did him any good. Of course, he had a very good start in his last start before he went on the disabled list. So we'll see if he could continue that momentum. The Pirates beat the Rockies 2-1 in Pittsburgh. Gerrit Cole was 5-3 on the year. Mark Melancon got his 14th save on the season. So we have that. Should be joined by Dave Hastings within the next 10 to 15 minutes. I believe we will talk to him for a little while. Get his thoughts on the playoffs. See what else is going on in the world of baseball right now. Yeah, another thing worth mentioning here is Tim Lenscombe resurfaced earlier this week. Of course, he didn't sign a contract this past offseason. He had his own little private showing for interested teams, and he signed a one-year deal with the Los Angeles Angels of Anaheim, which was announced earlier today, actually. His base salary is going to be short of $2 million, and he can earn additional incentives in the contract. He's trying to come back from left hip surgery. He didn't pitch after June 27th last year with the Giants because of degenerative issues with his hips. He had the surgery on September 3rd, didn't sign with a team after the end of his two-year, $35 million contract last season. It's tough joining another team because I've had a lot of emotions and time build up with the Giants, he said. He was 7-4 with a 4.13 ERA in 15 starts last season. His showcase for interested clubs was on May 6th. And if any team needs a shot in the arm, blast from the past, or a veteran to exceed expectations, it's the Angels. We've talked about some of their problems over the last few weeks with their ace, Garrett Richards, needing Tommy John surgery, being lost for the year. Andrew Heaney, who is expected to play a large role in their rotation, having problems with his UCL. And not being able to pitch since basically the first start of the year. So they really need someone to step up for them. They're currently in third place right now, which is more of a third place in the West, which is more of a testament to how bad the Astros have been than anything, really. The Rangers got off to a hot start. The Mariners, who have been very good thus far this season, but at 19-22, you know, they could still make a run here if they got a little bit more from their pitching staff. And, you know, another bat or two probably wouldn't hurt. Just to go through some numbers here. I mean, like we said, Hector Santiago is their de facto ace right now. They're still relying on Jared Weaver, even though he has a 5.76 ERA. Julius Chacin, they acquired from the Braves, I think last week it was. He's made two starts for them. Has not been very good for them. And you look at the guys who are making starts for him. Matt Schumacher made seven starts for him. He has an 8.49 ERA. Nick Tropiano is making starts for him. He's been doing decently for him, but a 1.58 whip. Yeah, that's not a guy you want to rely on. And the Angels have nothing in their farm system that could come up and kind of provide a shot in the arm for him. So they're relegated to seeing what they can get off the scrap heap. So for their sake, you just hope they can get anything out of Lincecum, because it will definitely be better than what they've gotten thus far from their starting rotation. See what else we got. Something else really going on with baseball right now. Talked about the rule changes, all that stuff. We'll switch to football a little bit. Try to talk football with Dave Tyson a little bit. Well, the one story to talk about is, you know, we talked the last few weeks about the NFL draft and how I felt that the Cowboys should have taken Jalen Ramsey with the 4th overall pick rather than Ezekiel Elliott. Well, you know, Jaguars, someone said if they didn't have bad luck, they would have no luck at all. Because Jalen Ramsey, all right, so we are back on the Sports Zone. I am your host, Mike Aglialoro, live on the I-95 Sports Radio Network, and we're going to bring in guests at this time.
Got me, bro?
I do. That's your theme song play, though, bro. All right. I apologize for the difficulties there, Dave, but you are on. How you doing, buddy? Dave Hastings, everybody.
What's going on, my friend? I got to say, I about 10 minutes ago, and you were talking your baseball, and I mean, obviously you know me well enough, I'm not the biggest baseball guy, but if there's one thing I do know is the Mets, and me and you are Mets fans, my friend, have been, let's say the word, or maybe the least degrading word would be disappointing. Specifically, offensively, and Matt Harvey.
Listen, we were talking about that earlier in the show, actually. I'm not going to argue with you. My problem with them, I talked about this a couple weeks ago. I went through some numbers. You know, it's great that the team knows how to hit home runs, but, you know, there's no balance. It's home run or nothing, and that's the problem with the last couple of games. I feel like they're just going up there trying to destroy deficits with one swing, and you can't do that. You have to play fundamentally. You have to be trying to at least get some base runners on base and get some runs that way. You can't be going up trying to solve it with one swing. And, you know, Harvey, he had the urinary tract infection. And, Dave, just so you know, you're kind of breaking up a little bit. Is everything all right with the connection you're on?
I do have you on the Bluetooth right now. I'm driving, but there was no way I was going to miss my opportunity to get on the show.
I hear you. You actually came in pretty good that time, so I feel like we solved it.
I just switched you off the Bluetooth, so it should sound a little bit better.
It does, absolutely. And I'm going to say one thing about Harvey, and then we're going to move on to basketball. Because I know you're kind of on some time constraints this week, so I won't keep you longer than necessary. As far as Harvey goes, listen, like I said earlier in the show, I feel like he's trying to do too much. I feel like he's trying to impress too many people. And he's not really just allowing himself to let it flow the way he did when he was taking the league by storm back in 2013. And I do think the urinary tract infection that he had earlier in the season probably came back from that a little too soon in hindsight.
Well, if there was one thing I wanted to bring up to you and actually get your side of the opinion.
Go ahead.
I had some sports talk radio on this morning on my ride to work, had it on during the lunch break, and even on my ride out from work. And one of the things they kept focusing on is thinking that Harvey's issues right now are actually not physical, but mental. And I was curious to know how you felt about that, because if there's one thing anybody that's ever played sports or follows sports on a regular basis knows, is if an athlete's mind isn't into what they're doing, I don't care what sport you're playing, it makes no difference. But if the athlete's mind is not into what they're doing, it really takes away from their ability to perform at their top level. And I was curious to know what you thought when it comes down to, is Harvey's issues really physical, or at this point, are they more mental?
Well, I said before you asked the question, I think it's a little of both. I think there is the mental aspect. Whether or not he's fully into it, I don't believe that a guy like Harvey is doing things halfway. Like I said, I feel like his problem is he's trying to do too much. I think he might be overthinking things. I think he might be thinking he has to correct himself on one pitch. He has to put everything into that one pitch. And I think that's why he's getting burned, because things aren't just flowing for him the way they used to when he was going right. I mean, you remember him in 2013. This was a kid, when he first came up, he looked like he got stronger as the day went on. But I heard one thing earlier today that I think is also part of it. We've never actually seen him be able to get out of, you know, when he's in a jam or anything like that. He's never had to pitch from behind before. And I think that adjustment is becoming a big thing for him. And I do think there's a physical aspect to it, too. Like I said, in hindsight, I wonder if maybe him coming back and pitching opening day after having that urinary tract infection less than a week before the season started was really a smart move.
Well, I mean, if there's one thing I can say in that regard, is the hardest thing to do with an athlete is to tell them not to be an athlete.
Yep.
I mean, we all watch baseball, you know, and anybody that watched baseball, I mean, you know, and maybe my opinion might be biased on this one, but so disrespect to baseball players, they're far from the best athletes on this world.
Agreed.
You know, they're not running a 40-yard dash at 4.3. They don't have 45-inch verticals. They're not bench pressing 225 pounds 30 times.
Mm-hmm.
But these guys, baseball is the definition. I would say baseball and golf, actually, it would be the definition of the combination of physical and mental attributes. You need to have the combination of both to be successful in either one of those sports. And,
I agree.
When I heard this conversation on the radio that I was listening to this morning, you know, I mean, there was a couple guys on the radio talking about how, you know, maybe he should seek the help of a sports psychologist.
I actually heard something to the effect that they were going to bring one in for him or something like that. Yeah.
And you know what? I mean, the bottom line is, if you're an athlete, if you compete in competitive sport where you get paid to do it, you are a level above anybody else. You don't get paid to play a game unless you are an exceptional person at what you're doing. Matt Harvey is an exceptional person at what he does. We've seen it.
Mm-hmm.
We know it. The Mets wouldn't be in the World Series if he wasn't a contributing factor last year. But the idea that whatever is going on in his mind, he can't separate and move beyond, is kind of troublesome if you're a Mets fan.
Mm-hmm.
Because you would like to hope and you would like to believe that his problems, just like the rest of us have our own personal issues we deal with, Mm-hmm. Yeah, we still get up, and every day we deal with what we got to deal with to make the most out of our lives. You would like to believe that a professional athlete could do the same thing. Now, none of us understand the pressure and the, you know, attention that these guys deal with. None of us can understand that. Not a single one. Unless you walk in the shoes, you don't know it. But we all deal with our own stuff, and yet we all still get up every day and deal with what we have to deal with. So, see, what's scary isn't even the short term is, you know, as a Mets fan speaking personally, what's scary is the idea of, all right, we know talent-wise, this guy deserves the best contract you can give him. But mentally, you can't separate yourself from whatever you have going on in your head to be able to step up and perform is a very scary concept, especially when you consider who his agent is. Because you know he's not accepting anything but the best. I mean, Boris still messed around.
That's very true, but I do also want to point out he wouldn't be the first one in baseball, a high-profile pitcher like him, to be in a position where maybe something's going on behind the scenes to affect his mental state. I'm reminded Zach Greinke. Early on in his career, he battled depression and things like that. And I don't think we're insinuating that Harvey has depression or anything like that. But Greinke, and he was coming off of a couple of high-caliber seasons with the Royals. And it was very early on, I believe it was 06 to beginning of the 05 season, or the end of the 05 season into 2006. He was almost out of baseball as a result of his depression. He had to overcome that. And then when he came back, he was actually a reliever at first, and then he went back into the rotation in 2008. So I get everything you're saying. I'm just saying that it has happened before with high-level pitchers who went on to have Cy Young and maybe even Hall of Fame caliber careers. Not that Greinke's really in that realm, but I think you get the point I'm making on that one.
Yeah, I mean, like I said, my opinion when I make that statement is strictly based on being a Mets fan.
Yeah.
Not being a baseball analyst, because anybody that knows me knows that baseball is by far my least favorite sport. I actually rather watch tennis and golf over baseball. But when it comes down to how I look at athletes and my opinion of how they handle themselves, you kind of sit there and you wonder to yourself, are you mentally as good as your physical attributes? And anybody that's played sports or anybody that watches sports on a serious level understands that to be successful in that world, it's a combination of athletic ability and mental ability. Because, you know, for how much, you know, just to go off onto, you know, to make the comparison. For how many people that are out there, and I will count myself as one of them, that may not be the biggest LeBron James fan. LeBron James was blessed with physical abilities. But to deal with the mental pressure and attention that he's received takes a whole nother level of human being. And he is he's done an amazing job. And for how much, I mean, I grew up a Jordan fan, so I'm always going to be biased against LeBron James. That's never going to change. But yet at the same time, if you can't respect what he's done and how he's handled himself, his attention, his talent, his situation, then you're kind of off the wall yourself. I mean, don't get me wrong. The decision was one of the stupidest and worst things I've ever seen in the world of sports. But he still went back to Cleveland. He's still doing doing what he can to help that franchise win a title. And when you watch the conference final so far, I kind of think you have to sit here and think Cleveland's the team to bet on. But we'll get into that a little bit later. All I'm trying to say is to be a great, you know, not a good, not a guy that earns his paycheck, but great. The guy that kids look up to, the guy that gets a Hall of Fame statue and plaque and maybe even a statue built in front of the stadium, that's a whole nother level. And I think really what I am trying to say is the reason I bring that up is even if Matt Harvey is dealing with personal and mental issues, if he wants to go down with the Nolan Ryans, who to me is still the greatest pitcher ever, and that might be based on age and genre, but either way, if he wants to go down even relevant to that category, whatever he has going on mentally, he needs to learn to set that aside. Because when you step on that field and you take that ball and you're ready to throw that first pitch and you hope, because there's no starting pitcher out there that doesn't hope they can go all nine innings, and he hopes that he can do that, whatever's going on in his personal life, he needs to learn to set that aside. And it really kind of bothers me that it's even a topic of conversation that they might have to bring in a sports psychologist to help him work through this.
I get exactly what you mean by there. So very quickly, one word answer here. Do you think it was deserved or classless, the booing when Harvey got taken out in the third inning yesterday?
Oh, wow. One word answer?
Yeah.
If I'm going to go one word answer, and before I say this, please understand, like I've said numerous times already on this call, far mm-hmm. from a baseball guy.
Yeah.
But if there's one thing I understand about baseball is there are some certain unwritten rules. So if that's the case, I'm actually going to go with classless.
Good.
Because to me, if you're going to swing at this guy, and not only swing at him, but connect the way he connected, you should have did it the first game of the series, not the last game.
Very true.
Because
very
true. If there's these unwritten rules, if you're going to retaliate for a bat flip that happened almost 6 months ago, that other team deserves the right to retaliate as well. And
true.
From my understanding, that team, those two teams only have like four more games against each other for the rest of the year.
Oh, no, dude, I wasn't talking about the Texas-Toronto thing. I said deserved the classless that they booed Harvey when Harvey got taken out after the third inning. Because the Mets fans in City Field, the Mets fans in City Field were booing him when he came off the mound.
All right. If that's what we're talking about, then I don't think that's deserved at all.
Yeah, good.
Because, you know what, the bottom line is the guy shows up, he goes to work, and he does what he does. And, yes, I did say, and I still stand by the fact that I said it, he needs to be able to put his personal stuff to the side and do his job.
Mm-hmm.
But if you're a fan, if you're a real fan, you support your team.
Mm-hmm.
Not supporting a singular player, because we all know in the world of sports that we live in now, a guy that plays for you for 5 years, that might be the only years you get with the guy.
True.
You root for your team. You don't boo some guy off by the third inning because he had a bad game. It's also not his fault that the Mets can't hit a fastball down the freaking middle of the plate.
Yeah.
I mean, these guys their top five hitters are averaging below 160 batting average. over the last, like, 10, 15 games.
Yeah.
You want to boo something, you boo their offense. You don't boo that pitching staff. That staff is the only reason this team is even relevant right now.
Very true. Very well said. Very well said. So with that, we'll switch gears. We'll move to the NBA playoffs. Kind of started on it a little bit. No playoff action tonight. Tomorrow night, Cleveland heads to Toronto for game 3. They are up 2-1, and Golden State will be taking on OKC in Oklahoma on Sunday night. Series tied there 1-1. What's your early impression of the conference finals so far on both series?
The fact that OKC won game 1 was amazing, but anybody that thought that meant they had a chance for the series is insane. We all knew, whether it was Miami or Toronto, that Cleveland was going to go through them. Either team might win a game, but if it goes past 5, I'd be blown away. I think Miami had the better chance between the two of them, between them and Toronto, to do something impactful against Cleveland. But to sit there and actually think that any team in the East had a chance against Cleveland, you're absurd. As long as Kyrie and Love are healthy, they are the East. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it.
Mm-hmm.
And if you thought differently, I think you're crazy. I also think if you watched OKC win that game in game 1 and thought that OKC could win the Western Conference, I also thought you were insane. Because you saw in game 2 that as soon as Steph Curry gets going, you're not beating that team. Even with Steph Curry having one of the worst games of his season in game 1, even with that, they still only won by a couple points. Mm. Yet Steph Curry goes off and it's, what, a 27-point win?
Yeah.
And I think that shows you, and I'll say one thing. If I'm going to talk about Golden State, if there's one thing I have to say, Draymond Green reminds me of Dennis Rodman, but a hell of a lot better on the offensive side of the ball. And the reason I say that is because the attitude and the mentality that he plays with is that of a guy who just looks at you and says, you can't stop me. And Rodman had that mentality when it came down to rebounding. Mm. Draymond Green has that mentality when it comes down to everything. And to me, I watched that guy, and I'm not a Warriors fan, so I kind of want to punch him in the face. Not even going to bite my tongue on that one. But at the same time, if you told me I could have him on the team I root for, I'd say please, please put him on my team. Because he's that good defensively, offensively, and more than anything else, he cares about winning. Mm. He doesn't care about a damn thing besides that. He wants to win.
Very true.
When it comes down to the world of sports, or the hell, life in general, when you want to succeed as badly as you want to breathe, is when you truly succeed. And he is the definition of that mentality. That man rather suffocate and die than lose a game.
Very true.
So just to bring, I had to say that because, like I said, I actually can't stand the guy. I really can't. Mm-hmm. I watch him and I'm like, I just want to punch you. But simultaneously, like I said, if you were willing to put him on my team, for by all means, please put him on my team.
Yep.
I'm pretty sure Rodman was the same way. Everybody hated him, but if he played on your team, you loved
him. Yep. I mean, no one would have ever thought that him and Jordan would have been able to coexist, and Jordan loved the guy when he played with him.
Exactly. And, and Jordan loved him because when he stepped on that court, he gave it everything he had and then
some. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And we've also heard some of the, what is it, the wild stories, how he'd be out partying until like 1 o'clock in the morning, we'd show up halfway through practice, and still have an amazing game that night. And it would be in playoffs. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. So, I mean, and that's like hearing the stories of Draymond Green fighting with Steve Kerr in the locker room. Yeah, he might have fought with him, he might have argued with him, but you know what Steve Kerr said? You're back in my starting lineup to tip off the second half.
Yep.
Because I know you're going to give me everything I need you to give.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So, I mean, here's my question. I don't think there's any disputing that the Cavaliers are going back to the finals. I don't think anybody disputes that one. I think it's a pretty solid bet that the Warriors get there too. But given how the Thunder were able to shock the Spurs, given what they did in Game 1, and given that they do have the size advantage, do you think there's any possibility that series goes to 7, or do you just think if Curry's on, there's no chance?
Well, what I'll say is if Curry is on, like how he was in Game 2,
mm-hmm.
there's no chance. If mm-hmm. Curry is the way he was in Game 1, it can go 7.
Mm-hmm.
I think the real split that you're looking at when it comes down to those two teams more than anything else is the role players, because Durant and Westbrook, and literally just Durant and Westbrook, when it comes down to offensively, can actually match Draymond, Steph, and Clay. They can match mm-hmm. all three of them because they're that damn good.
Mm-hmm.
But the difference is mentality. And what I mean by that is...
You all right back there?
Yeah, sorry. Dropped the phone.
That's okay. That's all right, dude. As long as you didn't fall.
The joy of doing this on a cell phone instead of having a mic in front of me, you know?
The joy of modern technology.
Yeah. So what I'm trying to say is anybody that watched Game 2 saw it with their own two eyes. In Game 2, it was a close game. You know, Game 1, they're down 13 going into the second half. And OKC kept their mentality strong. They didn't give up. They didn't make stupid decisions. They didn't make stupid plays. And they kept it going. Where in Game 2, you have a 9-point game. You're like 6 minutes into, you know, third quarter. Steph Curry hits two three-pointers in a row. You're down 15. That's only a 2-point difference between Game 1 and Game 2.
Mm-hmm.
But in Game 2, you have Kevin Durant, 5 turnovers in the first half.
Mm-hmm.
4 more turnovers, I believe it was. I might be wrong with the exact stats. I'm sorry if that's the case. But, you know, 3, 4, maybe even 5 more turnovers in the second half with stupid decisions, forcing passes that don't need to be passed. You have Westbrook chucking up 3-pointers that, yes, in Game 1 of the third quarter, he drops 19 points, and he throws up 3s that he ends up making, and you're like, oh, well, that was a smart decision. No, it still wasn't a smart decision. He made them. In the second game, he didn't make them. And I think that's actually your biggest separation between the two teams is a mentality, where Durant and Westbrook feel like they have to do everything. And in Golden State, whether it's Curry or Thompson or Green or Barnes or whoever the hell you want to name on that roster, they trust each other. They trust every single teammate that they have. And that, to me, is actually going to be your defining situation in the series. OKC is going to be able to keep every game possible and have the ability to possibly win any game. But they let themselves feel like between the two of them, they have to do it all. Where in Golden State, they believe in their system. They believe in what they're doing as a team compared to individually. And that is why, more than anything else, I believe Golden State takes this series in no more than six. I wouldn't be surprised if they close it out in five.
Well, it'll be interesting. And that series starts again on Sunday. I believe it's in OKC on Sunday. So we'll see on that one. Now, here's the big question here. Is Toronto's secret weapon to stop the Cavs getting the Border Patrol to stop Cleveland on their way into Toronto? Because I don't know if you heard, but Cleveland was, the Cavaliers were stopped by Border Patrol and held by customs for over an hour trying to enter Toronto.
I'd say that's about the only chance that they have.
That's their secret weapon right there. I just thought that was a funny little note to throw on there.
Yeah, I mean, so, if I was a betting man, that's the only chance they got.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, very true. Unless Lowry and DeRozan start shooting 80% field goal percentages, they have no shot in hell. And I honestly don't think even if they shot that, they'd really have a chance.
Now, what did you think about Kyle Lowry going to the locker room late in the first half? I believe he left with like 2.5 minutes left in the first half. What do you think about that? Because I know he's faced criticism. Believe in it, he said he needed to decompress. What do you think that says about Lowry that he wasn't with his team going for the whole half, going into halftime?
Don't get me wrong. I understand why people have a problem with it.
Mm-hmm.
But to me, it was, I think the best way to break that down is almost, you know, if you're in a relationship with somebody and you're dating or you're married or whatever it might be, you know that sometimes it's better to walk away than to blow up. And to get into a argument where nobody's going to win. And I think what you're looking at is Lowry was frustrated. He was angry. He was upset. And instead of sitting on the bench and being a negative influence and hurting his teammates, not just with his performance, but his mentality, it was better for him to walk away. And though I can understand 100% the issue that people might have with that, I think in the realm of the situation they were in, because keep in mind, when he walked away with 2 minutes left in the half, it was still a close game. He didn't walk away because he was pissed off at his teammates. Mm. He didn't walk away because he was pissed off at the game situation. He walked away because he was pissed off at how he was performing.
True.
And whether he acknowledges that or not, or that gets acknowledged when people talk to him or whatever, I don't really care. Because in my opinion, that's why he walked away.
Mm.
And he did that for the benefit of his team, with thinking in the long run. And when you're in a 7-game series, that's really the best way to do it. You know, sometimes you have to take a step back to avoid making things worse. And with how close the game was at that point, he may have actually done his team a favor. Now, do we know that as a fact? I don't know. But
very
what
true.
I do know is I don't think that was a slight on his team, how he felt about his team, nor how he felt about the situation. He knew his coach wasn't going to put him back in, and he knew that with how he was feeling at that time, it was better for him not to be there. So he went back there to, you know, unwind or relax or whatever, however you want to categorize it. But the bottom line is he didn't hurt anybody by doing it. And the only people that are probably making a big deal about it are the people that cover that stuff. So
very true.
I don't have an issue with it. Maybe if we were talking about Cleveland being in their situation and LeBron walked away, maybe my opinion might be different. It might be, because LeBron is a whole nother level than Kyle Lowry. But
very true.
In the situation we're talking about, I don't think there's anything wrong with what he did.
Fair point. I agree with it. When I first heard it, I thought he had walked out at the end of the game, which maybe I would have felt a little differently about, but doing it before halftime, I kind of agree with you and as you said on that one, that, you know, sometimes you just need to regroup, otherwise you do something that maybe you regret. So I agree with that. We'll skip around a little bit here. We'll talk about the draft lottery that was this week. And the 76ers finally get that number one pick that they've been looking for, basically for the last 3 years. They got the first pick. Lakers land the second pick. And, of course, if they had fallen out of the top three, that pick would have gone to Philadelphia. Boston gets the Nets pick at three. And your team, the Chicago Bulls, come home with the 14th pick. You almost had Sacramento's pick if it had fallen outside the top 10. So what are your impressions on the draft? What do you think the 76ers do with that first overall pick?
I think your safe bet is Simmons. But if there's anything that pops out to me about the draft lottery, is actually the Celtics being the number three pick. You're talking a team that had the talent to finish, what, third, fourth in the East?
They wound up with the fifth seed, I believe, but I think record-wise they might have been up there, yeah.
So you're talking a team with that much talent already. So before I keep going, let's rephrase this and say I think your two storylines are the Celtics and the Brooklyn Nets, who traded the farm to get Pierce and Garnett. And now we see why Boston was willing to do that. It's very hard as a fan of a team to look past the year that you're in. We all know that. Anybody that has a favorite sports team knows that. All we care about is right now and this year. And yet Danny Ainge was smart enough to understand that the players he had were not going to win him a championship. And he took a hit for 2 years after making that trade and not making the playoffs. And now look at the situation they're in. One of the most competitive teams in the East. And now they're going to draft number three in the draft. Now, are they going to get one of the top two prospects that everybody's talking about? No. But they're going to get one of the best players coming out this year and be able to add that to what's already a young and talented roster. And to me, they're actually the best story out of the draft. I mean, awesome for Philly, great for them, but no offense, I don't picture Simmons being Allen Iverson.
No, not at all.
You know, and we're talking, you know, a situation where, you know, the Sixers are a team that are 5 years, minimum, 5 years away from being a force in the East. even if they keep that entire squad together, they're 5 years, maybe four if they're lucky, from being the force in the East. So, you know, good for you, got the first pick. To me, Boston is a real story out of the draft.
Very true. Now, here's an interesting question for you here, and then we can move on a little bit. Because, I mean, we saw Boston, like you said, finish as one of the best teams in the East, basically. They made it to the fifth spot, and I think Ainge, like you said, deserves a lot of credit for the job he's done as general manager in terms of filling that team with talented players, giving them all the pieces in terms of draft picks, and I think he doesn't get enough credit for the trade he made to bring in Isaiah Thomas at the middle of last season, because I feel he's going to be a star. But I think the one thing we saw with the Celtics, and you kind of hit on it the last time you were on the show, they have a lot of role players, but they could use like that one big piece up front. Because they have three first-round draft picks this year. I believe they have Dallas's first-round draft pick, they have their own, and they have the Nets' first-round draft pick. Do you think it's possible that they try to package a couple of those picks together and go for broke, maybe talk to a team like Philadelphia, who, like you said, one player is not going to change their fortunes this season. Do you think they try to approach a team like Philadelphia and try to get a big man who can fill arguably the biggest need they have and get a guy like Jahlil Okafor if the 76ers will listen to something like the third overall pick and another one of those first-round draft picks?
Yes and no. Yes, do I think they'd package some things together to make a trade? No, when it comes down to trading with Philly. Believe it or not, I actually think the team you're looking at that they trade with is Sacramento and trying to get Boogie Cousins.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Because
Kings are ready to move on from him, though?
I think, based on what he has been personality-wise and how he's been as a teammate, Sacramento would be more than willing to get rid of him if the price was right. And I also think that Boston knows if they can add a superstar to that roster, that team can be a force in the East.
Mm-hmm. Now,
and
here's the go ahead.
All I was going to say is the NBA is about catching up with that team.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you look at the NFL, you know, you want to catch your division winner first. Once you know you can beat once you believe you can beat that team, your next concern is the top team in your conference, and then your next concern is the top team in the league.
Yeah.
In the NBA, your number one concern is always the top team in the league. And that's why the NBA doesn't have the following like the NFL or even baseball or hockey, is because you start the NBA season, pretty much every one of us already knows the Final Four, to use a college term. We all have an understanding and know, well, these most likely are the teams that will win it.
Mm-hmm.
So in the NBA, you're saying to yourself, we have to beat Golden State. That's what you're saying to yourself. No way. We need to beat Golden State, we need to beat the Spurs, and we need to beat Cleveland. That's it. Nobody else is worried about any other team. And if you're Boston, you know you have the talent to compete with Boston or compete with Cleveland. You know you're not going to beat them, but you know you can compete with them. So instead, you're saying, what do we need to beat Cleveland? And that's why, to me, Boston isn't going to trade with a Philly to get an Okafor and hope in a couple years down the road they can do it. You look at a DeMarcus Cousins and you add him into that rotation and that roster, you're looking at a very interesting team. Can they beat Golden State? Probably not. But you're looking at a very interesting team. And I think that's the team they look to trade with.
Now, here's my follow-up to that, because that's a very interesting point you bring up, very interesting player. Given, I mean, you look at Boston, they were able to do so much this year as a result of the team chemistry they have, the fact that everyone bought into the system that Brad Stevens put on the table, and it was very much a team-driven effort. You know, everyone had a part in there. You look at a guy like Cousins, and you said it, not the best teammate, not the best guy in terms of dealing with the head coach, not a guy who's really going to generate a lot of positive vibes, at least from a personality standpoint, from the front office. Do you think Boston would really risk bringing in a guy like that into their locker room? Or do you think Boston is the franchise that could really kind of rein him in?
I would go more with the rein him in. And the reason I say that is, first of all, I think Brad Stevens should have got Coach of the Year.
He's a great one. He's going to be an amazing coach for a long time. Yeah.
He did more with less than anybody. No disrespect to Steve Kerr or even Luke Walton. But if you actually look at the regular season, Luke Walton actually had a better record than Kerr. We're only talking by one game. We're not talking drastic here. We're talking one game difference record-wise. But he still did better than Kerr. And to me, Stevens did the most with the least. I also think Danny Ainge is the best GM in the league.
Oh, yeah.
I think he knows exactly how to handle everything and how to make the most of everything. So to me, you bring Cousins in, you make it very clear to him, even before the trade is official, what you have expectations of him. And if he can't agree with that, you explain to him that, well, you can deal with mediocrity and just making a lot of money, have fun. Because all of us know these athletes make the money they make. But deep down inside, they care more about winning than anything else.
That's very true.
I don't care.
Go ahead.
I was just going to say, I don't care what athlete you're talking about. I don't care what sport you're talking about. These guys play the game because they want to win. They go back to how they were when they were 16 years old playing on their high school team. And all they care about is winning and how they're remembered. And Cousins, for how many issues you can name about him and how many negative things you could say about him, that man deep down inside still wants to win. And I think, to me, Danny Ainge and Stevens and the culture they have in Boston would get that across to him. And if he couldn't accept that, they'd get rid of him. Danny Ainge would take a crappy deal and get rid of him. He wouldn't care because he would know in the long run that was the right thing to do. I think that the culture there and who Ainge is and who Stevens is would be able to either rein him in or get across to him that we'll send you to the worst team in the league and just hope we win the lottery again because we're not going to put up with your crap.
Yeah. Hey, listen, on the surface, if we're talking just talent-wise, he could conceivably be the next in line in that famous lineage they have that goes all the way back to Burt Russell into the 80s with Robert Parrish. He would be that next big man. So at least that's from a talent standpoint, if he was able to buy into everything. So I'll give you that one. I know you got to run. I want your comments on there's been a lot of coaching changes over the last couple weeks. And this week we had two more. Obviously, the ones that have gone on since the last time we were here, the Lakers got Luke Walton. Indiana Pacers promoted Nate McMillan to replace Frank Vogel. Kings got Dave Joerger after he was let go by the Grizzlies. The Knicks got Jeff Hornacek. And the Orlando Magic hired Frank Vogel. The Grizzlies and the Rockets are the only teams that have not named new head coaches. So if, of these five, what coaching hire do you like the most, and which one do you think has the most impact on their team this coming season?
I like the one I like the most is Orlando and Vogel.
Mm-hmm.
I think Vogel brings a certain mentality. I think that Indiana actually makes a mistake by letting him go. And that's no disrespect to Nate McMillan. It really isn't. I mean, no disrespect towards him. But I think Vogel's a great coach, and he was dealing with a team that didn't have enough talent to compete in the East. When it comes down to my biggest disappointment is the idea of Houston looking at D'Antoni.
Yeah, no, that's very true.
You know, the team whose biggest issue was playing defense, going to hire a coach that doesn't believe in defense is kind of mind-boggling to me.
Mm-hmm.
I think the most unpredictable and unknown is Hornacek in New York.
Mm.
You know, Phil Jackson wants the triangle, and, you know, that's what he believes in, and we all know Hornacek did not run a triangle, but yet we all know what, you know, if you're a basketball fan, you know what he was in the NBA.
Mm-hmm.
He was arguably one of the greatest role players in the history of the league.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and this is a guy that played side-by-side with John Stockton, and yet, if you put him on a different team, would have been a Hall of Famer without playing by John Stockton.
Because
he was that good.
Yep. No, he played with Stockton. He was on the Suns. I believe he was on the Suns in 93 when they went to the finals. And if I'm right on that, he actually played Phil Jackson and Michael Jordan in the finals on three separate occasions.
Yes. Yeah, I believe you're correct. I can't say I know off the top of my head.
Yeah, I should probably look that up, but I'm pretty sure on that one.
But that, to me, was definitely, without a doubt, the most surprising hire.
Mm-hmm.
I love Vogel in Orlando. You already have Oladipo to be your superstar because he's working his way towards that.
He's a great player. I love Oladipo.
It'll be really interesting to see if Dwight Howard ends up back in Orlando. I can't imagine they
really bring him back. I mean, truthfully, they have one of the more underrated centers in the league right now with Nikola Vucevic. I really can't see them bringing Dwight Howard back.
Yeah, and I agree with you, but you saw what Vogel made Hibbert.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, no disrespect to Hibbert, but Vogel made him a lot better than he seems to be.
I was wrong, actually. Hornacek, and I forgot this, Hornacek was traded to the 76ers before the 92-93 season in the Charles Barkley trade. I forgot about that. So he only was
that, but that's where you got the Suns from, so at least you're not too far off.
No, I knew he was with the Suns. I forgot about the Barkley trade, though. Yeah.
But, yeah, I'll definitely say I think Vogel's my favorite hire, Hornacek my most surprising, and D'Antoni, if it ends up happening, will be my most disappointing because that team needs defense, not offense.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I'll say this about the Hornacek hire, because I like that move. I was surprised, as you were, that Hornacek went to the Knicks. I think with him coming in, the thing he ran very well with the Suns is it was a very guard-heavy offense. It was almost a D'Antoni clone-like offense that he ran. So, to me, and it had aspects of the triangle in it, even though it wasn't a full triangle offense. The thing to me is, if they're going to run a system that fits what Hornacek can do, they need to get better in that backcourt. And the big question I have is, do you think they're going to be able to run as many fast breaks if they get the pieces, given where Carmelo Anthony is in his career, given his health and his knees?
Well, I mean, to me, one of the, I actually had this conversation with a couple friends the other day.
Mm-hmm.
For how much a coach can impact a game or a team, the NBA is the definition of superstar power.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
So, you look at the Knicks, and let's be honest, if Melo can stay healthy and Porzingis keeps getting better, I don't care who you put in as coach, you got a chance.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, Hornacek was, what, 101? I think he was 101 wins to, like, 112 losses in Phoenix before they let him go.
It's something like that. And the only reason the losses piled up is because of this past season. And he was really hurt by that whole Markieff Morris saga with the way he kind of acted like a child after they traded away his twin brother. He got in the whole confrontation with him, and the season was kind of doomed from the start. And plus, all the moves they made. You know, when he had that really big season, it was because of, they had Dragic, and they had Eric Bledsoe. And then, what was it, last season, they added Isaiah Thomas to that. And then they traded Dragic and Thomas away at the deadline. You brought in Brandon Knight. You didn't have the same chemistry. And then they added Tyson Chandler for some unknown reason.
Yeah, I think, you know, I mean, I think Hornacek has potential with the Knicks, but it's more talent on the roster than him as a coach.
Mm-hmm. Very true.
So,
very true. Yeah.
But, yeah, I mean, I actually do have to wrap it up with you, Mike.
Mm-hmm.
So,
do you have
anything else you want to throw out real quick?
No. Listen, man, I want to thank you for hanging with me as long as you did. I want to apologize for everything at the beginning. I know you said you were waiting for 10 minutes. I don't know what happened with my computer, but it wasn't bringing up anything. And then when you texted me, I was like, all right, the problem's here. I have to reset this. So I want to apologize for the whole thing, and I want to thank you for being with me this week and staying for as much of the hour as you could.
It was my pleasure, Mike, man.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks to all the listeners out there, and thanks for having me on, bud. I'll talk to you later.
All right, man. Hopefully we'll talk to you next week, too.
Sounds good, bud. Have a good one.
Yep, take care, Dave.
Bye.
All right. Okay. So that was Dave Hastings on the Sports Zone with your host, Mike Aglialoro, coming to you live on the I-95 Sports Network. We're going to wrap up in a little while. Anybody wants to call in before we go, the phone number is 605-562-8001, and you dial 5 to get on the air. We're going to go back to the baseball scoreboard momentarily just to see where we're at. Some of the games have wrapped up right now. So, like I said, we'll see where we're at here. Seattle stormed in front of the Cincinnati Reds. They are up 8-3 in the top of the ninth inning. Toronto laid the hammer down on Minnesota. They're up 9-2 heading into the bottom of the ninth. Kansas City taking control from the Chicago White Sox 4-1 in the top of the ninth. They have a man on first with only one out. Arizona's up 4-2 over St. Louis, and they have the opportunity for a whole lot more as they have the bases loaded in the top of the eighth inning with only one out. We're in the top of the fourth in Oakland, and the Yankees are losing 1-0 to the A's in the top of the fourth, like I said. At the end of the second inning, Baltimore is up 2-1 over the Angels. The Dodgers are scoreless. They're in the first inning. And the Cubbies have two men on in the top of the second inning with only one out. Currently scoreless, but that could change momentarily against the Giants. As we said, the Mets got back on the winning track with a 3-2 win, aided by Michael Conforto's long ball and seven innings out of Steven Matz, who pitched six scoreless innings after giving up two runs in the first inning to push his mark to 6-1 on the year. Atlanta beat the Phillies 7-1, backed by a strong performance by Matt Whistler, who Mets fans know very well. He's 2-3 on the year. Aaron Nola takes his third loss of the year against three wins for Philadelphia. Cleveland beat the Boston Red Sox 4-2. Backed by Corey Kluber, who gets his third win of the season. Clay Buchholz takes the loss there. Cody Allen picked up his 10th save of the season. Tampa Bay continues to extend the Detroit Tigers losing ways as they win 7-5. Matt Andreese got his third win of the season. Anibal Sanchez takes his fifth loss of the year. And Alex Colome takes his 11th save of the season. Man, it's amazing. He has 11 saves already. This was the guy who's a converted starter. They put him in the bullpen. Didn't really look like he would be the guy they would think to go to. But after Brad Boxberger went down, he's really been the guy who kind of took over that closer's role and ran with it. And as we said, Washington beat the Marlins. And Texas beat the Houston Astros 2-1. Lance McCullers takes his first loss of the season. Kobe Lewis the win. Sam Dyson gets his third save for the Rangers. So, see what else we got going on here. The only thing I'm going to mention football-wise is the Jets. Still don't know what is happening in terms of Ryan Fitzpatrick. They are still at a stalemate. He's still a free agent. And it does not look like they're really budging on their stance. And as I started to say before we were joined by Dave, Jaguars rookie Jalen Ramsey, who they took at number 5 and who I kind of thought the Cowboys should have taken over, Ezekiel Elliott, has a partially torn meniscus. It's a phase 2 tear in his right knee. He got it on on-field workouts earlier this week. They didn't know. A source told ESPN's Adam Schefter that Ramsey was hurt during a drill but didn't know it at the time. The knee was sore after practice, and it led to an MRI the next day, which revealed the tear. So they're not entirely sure how long he's going to miss because of it. There are two possible courses of surgical treatment. One would keep him out from 4 to 6 weeks, which would put him back in time for the season. The other one would keep him out for 4 to 6 months. He's going to Dr. James Andrews next week for a second opinion. If you know anything about professional sport, you know anytime you have to go to Dr. James Andrews, it's never a good thing. So going back to the Jets right now, you know, in my opinion, the Jets have to get Ryan Fitzpatrick back on board. It would be better for their team. You don't really want to go into this season having to rely on Geno Smith or even the rookie Christian Fetterick. You want both of them to be in a position where they can kind of sit back a little bit, and if they have to go into games later in the season, you can do that. But obviously, with Smith, Frederick, and Bryce Petty, the Jets are probably confident enough that they can go into this season without Fitzpatrick if they have to, start the year off with Smith, and then if he falters, you would probably see Frederick in at some point this year. But from everything you've heard about Frederick, and it hasn't exactly been awe-inspiring here. He had a great rookie season in Penn State, I believe, but didn't exactly have the best seasons after that. They seem to have high hopes for him, according to the director of personnel, Brian Heimerdinger. Here's a great name. Said it on Thursday on a radio show in Nashville. According to him, he had a tough time in college, but he's an unbelievable kid, real smart. I've really enjoyed him so far since he's been in the building. We'll see how he progresses over the next couple of years. The fact is, he's considered a project. I don't think this means the end of Bryce Petty necessarily, but I think when they took Bryce Petty, they looked at him as a long-term project, too. And I don't think Frederick is someone you consider as long of a project as Petty, but I'm saying Frederick the whole time, thinking the Padres pitcher, Christian Hackenberg. Damn. Okay, completely wrong on that one. Christian Hackenberg. Excuse me, folks. Wow. Okay. Hackenberg obviously is not considered as much of a long-term project as Petty, but he's not someone I really feel you can throw right into the fire and make your starter week one. Now, Heiberdinger was asked about the Ryan Fitzpatrick stalemate. He said, you hope to find some middle ground somewhere. I think we've said it all along as an organization that we want him back, and I don't think that's changed. We'll see how it plays out over the next couple months. We're hoping to get him back. Listen, the bottom line here is at this point in the offseason, Fitzpatrick is not getting the big-dollar contract he wants. I don't think he's getting that from Denver, even though Sanchez did get his injury last week and is probably going to miss a few weeks. I can't see anyone paying big money to start Ryan Fitzpatrick, and you're not getting him on big dollars to be a backup. So at this point, his best chance to get any sort of a payday is to take whatever the Jets offer is. And I do think at some point over the next month, he's going to wind up signing. I mean, we're already at the voluntary workouts and everything. OTAs will be starting soon. And, you know, training camps come after that. So this is going to end at some point, I would say before the middle of June. With that, we're going to sign off for tonight. Once again, I want to thank Dave Hastings for joining us on the show. It was great to have him back. Hopefully, we'll see him next week. Big shout-out to Dave Tice, even though he wasn't able to be here this week. Should be getting him back in a couple weeks. If you guys get a chance, I am going to be back with you on the I-95 Sports Network on Sunday from the silver screen to the small screen. It's going to be our second show. Had a little special Sunday night. We talked some comic book movies. We talked Game of Thrones. Great episode of Game of Thrones this past week. If anybody didn't get a chance to see it, I highly recommend seeing it. We're going to be talking Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. season finale and what that means for the future. And I do, if anybody was listening on Sunday, I apologize for the audio problems we had. We had those same audio problems on this show a few weeks ago, and I'd like to think by the time we're back on Sunday, as you might be able to tell tonight, those problems hopefully will be in the past. So please join us on Sunday, 7 o'clock Eastern Standard Time, from the silver screen to the small screen. This program will be back with you next Friday at 9 p.m. SportsZone. Next week will be week 7. I want to thank you guys for joining us for tonight's program. Once again, thank you to Dave Tice. Big shout out to the head of the